Because, answered Vantamon, in tones of dangerous patience, you're closer to them, and unlike you, I have important work to attend to. You can go back to your lazing about when the job is over. Hmph, said Edamon. You sound reluctant, Vantamon said smoothly, his pointed teeth glittered in the darkness. Would you prefer I told Padmon you do not wish to serve him after all? Oh, shut up, I'll do it, Edamon snapped, but only because I have nothing better to do right now. I was well aware of that, answered Vantamon. Well, what are you waiting for? Get going. Before Edamon could say anything, the picture dissolved into static, then went dark. Edamon scowled at the blank screen. One of these days I'm going to shove those pointy teeth right out the other side of your head, he said. He turned on his heel and stalked off, muttering. Thinks he's so special, just cause he kisses up to Piedmon, like to take them both down a peg or three. Leaving the control room, he nearly tripped over a Gazimon called Longears. The creature began to babble apologies, which Edamon halted with a wave of his hand. Round up the others, he ordered. We're moving out.
We are? Asked Longears, blinking in confusion. We just got here.
Did I say we were moving or not? Edamon demanded. When I say we're moving, you don't tell me we're not. You move. Longears moved with a squeak. He hurtled out of the trailer as fast as his paws could carry him. Feeling somewhat relieved by making the Gazimon jump, Edamon loped off to the head of the trailer train to supervise the activity. Meanwhile, Patch continued with his work. He was very good at the cleaning job. He was the only one besides himself that Edamon allowed to care for them, and he took the honor seriously. Each instrument that came through his paws was polished until it was mirror bright, and then carefully tuned. Now he was just finishing, but only the tip of his tail betrayed how anxious he was to be done. He went over the final instrument, a deep violet guitar with a metallic sheen, to be sure there wasn't a speck of dust on it. Satisfied that it was perfect, he hung it back on its rack. Now at last, he could turn his attention to his new gift. For a moment, all he could do was sit and admire it. Dusty and scuffed as it was still his, and that made it more precious than anything. He promised himself he'd clean it up and make it the cleanest instrument on the continent. He reached for the polish, and it lurched away from him. The floor trembled, and Patch gave a squeak of fright as he felt the room around him rock. For some unaccountable reason, the trailer had started to move. Why? They weren't scheduled to go anywhere today. There was no time to think about that now. Patch gave another yelp as he felt the trailer go careening over a dune. Wherever they were going in a hurry. With everything shaking around, it was all Patch could do to keep hold of his precious guitar. He held onto it with all fours and screwed his eyes shut tightly, feeling himself slide around the floor as it rocked beneath him, as if he were riding a sled. Bang! The back door, imperfectly closed, popped open as the trailer bounced over a rut. The force of the bump sent Patch bouncing up into the air. He lost his grip on the guitar and could only watch helplessly as it skidded wildly across the floor. As the trailer began rolling up the hill, the guitar slid inexorably downwards toward the open door. No, come back! Patch wailed. The guitar slid out the door, its neck wrapped, actually wrapped is spelled with a W, this is a good story anyway, its neck wrapped against the door frame as it went by, striking a plaintive twang, for all the world as if it were begging to be rescued. Then it fell out the door to land in a heap of sand. Patch half ran, half tumbled toward the door to stare after it. Come back! Come back! Come back! He shouted.
He stared helplessly as it got further and further away. Now what was he supposed to do? He had promised Edamon he would keep it clean and safe. Now it was both dirty and lost. Somehow he had to get it back. He howled as he leapt out the door. He hit the side of a dune and tumbled top over tail until finally coming to a halt at the bottom next to his guitar. The trailer continued to rumble away, disappearing over the top of a dune. The open door swung backwards and slammed shut. "Wait!" Patch shouted at it. "You messed without Patch!" Nobody heard him. He watched sadly as it rolled over another dune and seemed to vanish into a cloud of dust. He hung his head. "All gone," he said mournfully. He looked back at his guitar. It was covered in sand, but otherwise no worse than it had been before. With some difficulty, he managed to sling it on his back. One thing was absolutely certain in Patch's mind. He had to bring the guitar back to Edamon at all costs. Dropping to all fours, he began to trot clumsily across the sand. Edamon ordered the caravan to halt after a half hour of traveling. He said he wanted to give the draft animals a break. Truthfully, he didn't want to go any closer to the eastern territory. That area was full of trees. Trees did have their uses, like growing bananas, but he didn't like traveling through them. He preferred the wide open desert spaces, if only because he liked the image of racing like the wind in his trailer. It was harder to race like the wind when there were a bunch of trees and things in the way. Anyway, he said he would deal with the trouble at hand, but he didn't say he would do it quickly. It was only after they had parked and gotten resettled that Edamon finally got around to wondering where his servant had gotten off to. It had been almost an hour, all told, since he had left Patch to his polishing. Patch was a fast worker. He should have been done by now and trotting at his master's heels while he waited for another job to do, even factoring in time to play with the new toy. He still should have been done by now. "Where is that long-eared rodent anyway?" he asked the general air.
"Which one, Edamon-sama?"
a nearby Gazimon inquired. Edamon glared. He knew all the servants by name, but it was demeaning to have to actually call them by such, as if they were important. "Patch, you overgrown weasel! The clumsy little dust mop that's always following me around. Where is he?"
"I don't know," the Gazimon answered. "I thought he was with you."
"If he was with me, wouldn't he be here, moron?" Edamon bellowed. "When I say I want to know where someone is, it means I want to know where someone is. Go find him, now."
"Yes, Edamon-sama, right away."
He scampered away just in time to avoid being kicked. While he scurried off to search, Edamon began to head back to his trailer. Maybe Patch was still in there. "If he's in there goofing off when he ought to be out here paying attention to me, I'll make him sorry he ever dreamed of playing the guitar." However, Patch wasn't in the room with the guitars, though there was evidence that he had finished his cleaning there. Where else would he be? He couldn't have been stupid enough to go back to the Gazimon dorms with the guitar, not when he was sworn to keep it a secret.
"Edamon-sama!"
Edamon jumped. The Gazimon had come up behind him so quietly that he hadn't heard him arrive.
"What?" he snapped. "Did you find him?"
"No, Edamon-sama," said the Gazimon apologetically.
"We're still looking. I was just sent to tell you that your dinner is ready."
"Oh, well, why didn't you say so in the first place?" Edamon replied. For a moment, he considered continuing his search, but he quickly dismissed the idea. Patch would turn up sooner or later, and when he did, Edamon would deal with him better when he'd replenished his strength. He was hungry. Anything else would wait until he'd remedied that.
"Fine," he said.
When that rabbit ear runt turns up, tell him off for me, and then send him to me so I can tell him off. Got it?
Yes, Edamon Sama.
Edamon waved a hand in dismissal, his mind already on food. Dinner was always the best meal of the day. It was his habit to sleep late in the mornings, and he didn't like having to wake up early because he was hungry. So it was important to have a solid evening meal. When he arrived at the dining car, he found a comfortable chair drawn up to a long table, which was piled from end to end with more food than he could have possibly eaten, with a massive banana split as its crowning glory. He vaulted into his chair and eyed the repast, rubbing his hands together in anticipation. "Oh yeah, come to Papa," crooned. I could actually see him saying that. He began to eat greedily, shoveling down his meal without any regard for table manners, silverware, or cleanliness, getting crumbs down his front and on most everything else in the general vicinity. It was only when he couldn't have eaten another crumb without bursting that he collapsed back in his chair with a satisfied sigh. He looked around. Normally, Patch would have been lurking in a corner patiently waiting for his turn, but he was still nowhere in sight. Oh well, his loss. Edamon didn't feel like getting up to look for him. Actually, he stretched and yawned hugely. He didn't feel like moving at all. Who said he didn't work hard at his job? Why, he was exhausted right now. Nothing would suit him better, he decided, than to take a quick nap. Wherever his wayward servant had gotten off to, he could look after himself until Edamon was good and ready to find him. Patch had no idea where he was. His sense of direction wasn't reliable at the best of times, and when it came to wandering the desert without a single landmark, he almost couldn't help but get lost. He thought he'd been walking in the same direction as the trailers, but the windswept sand left no trace of their passing, and Patch had slowly but surely gone off course. He had actually managed to overshoot the parked caravan and was now moving in the direction of the forest that grew on the eastern border. He was very tired. Just when he was ready to collapse, something caught his eye. He paused and looked up. Ahead of him was a smudge of dark forest, and moving in the forest were lights. His ears pricked up. It had to be the others. Who else would be burning lights out here? He picked up his pace, trotting as fast as he could toward the light. Meanwhile, nestled as comfortably as they could be, the chosen children slept. Thus far, their stay on server had been uneventful, but they still had warnings from friends and enemies alike ringing in their ears, warning them of the dangerous beasts who were said to live there. Everyone was still a little edgy, even tired as they were. Takiru, or Tai, clutching... Oh, sorry, not Tai. What am I saying? TK, Takiru, clutching Poyomon tightly to his chest, whimpering in his sleep, as if troubled with dreams. Others simply sprawled on the ground in attitudes of complete exhaustion. One or two Digimon snored softly. Only two people were completely awake. With a yawn born as much of boredom as anything else, Tai Chi stirred the fire, making the light flare higher. Funny the things you develop a knack for when you were out in the wilderness. He'd never known the first thing about how to keep a fire going when he was back in Japan. His only experience is being limited to watching one from a distance at summer camp and one instance of joining some friends for a sweet potato roast. Now, out here, they all had learned how to look after a campfire, and most of them had gotten fairly adept at cleaning fish and whittling tools as well. Now Tai Chi smiled faintly as he felt the renewed rush of warmth and breathed the smell of smoke. "At least I'm doing some good," he commented to Agumon, For a place that's supposed to be crawling with powerful Digimon, this place is pretty dead. How much longer till the next watch? Agumon raised his blunt nose to the sky, taking in the positions of the moon and stars. It's just a little after midnight, Dinosaur replied. We still have about a half an hour left before we have to wake up Sora. Rat, Tai Chi muttered. I'm bored. I feel like I've been sitting here watching this fire for hours. Watch something else, Agumon suggested innocently. I'll watch the fire for you, Tai. I'm good at fire. What am I going to watch? Sand? Asked Tai Chi irritably, waving at the scenery beyond the forest edge. Nevertheless, Tai Chi scrambled to the top of a nearby rock and sat down on top of it, pulling his handy telescope from his pocket. The telescope was a simple affair made of inexpensive materials, but in this place, he wouldn't have traded it for all the gold in Fort Knox. For something I got from a cereal box offer, this thing sure does come in handy, he said to himself as he raised it to his eye. Looking out over the desert, he saw exactly what he'd expected to see. Sand, sand, and more sand, studded with occasional rock or cactus. The moonlight made it shine white as snow, but the children and their partners had gotten a look at it before the sun went down, and they knew it would be a miserable obstacle to try to cross. They didn't intend to try it. Some scouting around had convinced the Digimon that there was a village not far from here, and they hoped to reach it the next day and ask for directions, or at least supplies to get them across that ocean of sand. With a sigh, Tai Chi prepared to turn around for a look in the other direction. Even if nothing was moving tonight, it would be more interesting to look back at the trees than at that featureless wasteland. Just as he was moving, he caught a glimpse of something that looked out of place. He peered through his telescope, twitching the focus. Something he had first taken to be an oddly shaped rock was moving slowly but steadily across the sand. It was nothing Tai Chi had seen before. Hey Agumon, he called. Come here and take a look at this. Agumon scampered up the side of the rock. What is it? Look through here and tell me if you've ever seen a Digimon like this before. Tai Chi passed the scope to Agumon, who peered through it curiously. That looks like a Gazimon, he said. He twiddled the knob of it. Yeah, it is a Gazimon. Is that good or bad? Tai Chi asked. Not good. Gazimon have a bad reputation. They're tricksters and thieves. You've got to have eyes in the back of your head when Gazimon are around. Let me look again. Agumon passed the telescope back to Tai Chi. The Gazimon was closer now, and he could get a better look at it. Looks like that one has a good haul tonight, Tai Chi commented. What's that he's got on his back? Agumon looked through the telescope again. It looks like a guitar. Huh? Let me see. Tai Chi snatched his scope back and looked. Well, I'll be. It's a guitar, all right. Why would anyone want to carry a guitar across the desert in the middle of the night? Maybe he did steal it, Agumon suggested. Maybe he wants to get it hidden before the sun comes up. Well, why steal a guitar? Why not something more valuable? I don't know, answered Agumon with a shrug. Maybe he wants to be a musician. Maybe he's just weird, said Tai Chi. You know, if that guy keeps going the way he's going to walk right into our campsite. Agumon glanced over his shoulder, looking back at the campsite, where the fire was still crackling merrily. He could be heading for the light. I bet the fire shows for a long way over the desert. Tai Chi looked at the fire, then at Agumon. Why didn't you mention that before we lit the fire? He demanded. Agumon shrugged. I thought you knew. Some expert outdoorsman I am, Tai Chi muttered. Maybe we better put it out. Good idea. Three more pages. The two of them doused the fire with handfuls of sand, burning the embers and plunging the campground into shadow. The change in light woke a few of the uneasy sleepers, We begin looking for the source of the change.
It isn't morning yet,
Mimi murmured. Joe sat up and put on his glasses.
What's going on?
You didn't let the fire burn out, did you, Tai Chi?
Shh, Tai Chi hissed. Something's coming.
The others were awake instantly.
What is it they wanted to know?
Just a little Digimon, but we don't want to attract its attention, said Tai Chi. Hopefully it'll go by us in the dark, but if it doesn't, we ought to be ready for it. The others nodded their agreement. Crouching together over the remains of the fire, they began to formulate a plan. Out on the sands, Patch was dismayed to see the lights go out. They had been such nice, cheerful things to follow, and Patch didn't like being alone in the dark. Doggedly as his natural nature dictated, he continued to trot in the direction the lights used to be. If everyone else was there, he was bound to hear or smell them if he just got close enough. However, there was no familiar sound or scent as he reached the edge of the forest. He was just starting to wonder what he should do next when something he had taken for a perfectly innocent vine shot out and lashed around his ankle. The next thing he knew, he had been lifted up off the ground. He gave a yowl of unhappiness as his guitar slipped out of his grasp and fell to the ground with a bong. Hanging upside down from one paw, he saw Palmon step out of the woods, followed by several other Digimon, as well as some other creatures he couldn't identify. Strange beasts wearing pieces of cloth over their pink skins, and with their only fur growing on the tops of their heads. One of them, one with tufts of reddish fur sticking out from under a blue cap, gave him an examination.
This is what you got us all working up for? She asked. It doesn't look so dangerous to me.
Well, how was I supposed to know? Answered another strange creature, this one wearing a pair of goggles over his bushy brown fur.
Agumon said these things are tricky. I didn't want us all robbed blind while we sleep.
Robbed by what? Asked another of the strange creatures. This one wore glasses, and his fur was darker than the others. It's not like we have much to begin with.
Put me down! Put me down! Patch wailed.
Not until you tell us who you are and what you're doing out here, said the boy with the goggles.
Shall we, shall we, shall we? Patch wailed. Patch doesn't want to come here. Patch wants to go home.
Much to the children's surprise, their captive burst into tears, wailing like a kicked puppy. Mimi clapped her hands over her ears. Yamato gave Tai Chi a superior smile.
So much for your dangerous Digimon, Tai, he said.
Oh, shut up, Tai muttered.
Okay, Palmon, I think you can put him down now. I kind of doubt he's going to hurt us. Palmon set the little Gazimon gently on the ground. Instantly, he picked up the guitar he'd been carrying and began inspecting it for damage. Yamato, who had always been interested in music, knelt for a better look.
Where'd you get this thing?
He asked. Tai Chi gave the Gazimon a suspicious look.
You didn't steal it, did you?
The Gazimon gave him an affronted look.
Patch didn't steal nothing. Just borrowed it. Enemon Shama gave it to Patch to borrow. Patch wasn't doing nothing wrong.
Why does everyone blame everything on Patch?
Don't be too hard on him, Tai Chi, said Yamato, examining the guitar. This thing's been through the mill. Whoever this Enemon is, he was probably glad to get rid of it.
Enemon Sharma gave it to Patch, said Gazimon, still looking annoyed. It's a present.
All right, said Yamato. I didn't mean to insult you. Sensitive little thing, aren't you? The little Gazimon just pouted. Not an easy thing for a dog to do. And now they say it's a dog.
Well, come to think of it, Edamon probably wouldn't be the best source for information on what animals are. I mean, he called Ikakumon a goat. And last I checked, goats can't swim.
Now where was I? Oh. Well, tell you what. Say, Tai Chi. Said Tai Chi. Do you think this Edamon character is likely to come looking for you? Hatch nodded vigorously. Well then, why don't you sit tight with us until he gets here? Tai Chi suggested, it'll be easier to find if you're sitting still than if you're moving around, right? Guess so, said Hatch, looking puzzled as he tried to work through the logic of this. Hatch should wait for Edamon to get here, hmm? That's right, said Sora. You just sit and wait, and we'll keep an eye on you until he gets here. Are you sure that's such a good idea? Asked Joe. I mean, we have no idea what an Edamon is. What if he turns out to be dangerous? Oh, come on, said Yamato. Just look at this little guy. He obviously looks up to this Edamon. How bad could he be? Famous last words. Somewhere in the desert, Edamon woke up. He had been dreaming uneasily of bats and shadows, and didn't feel greatly comforted to wake up in the dark. He looked around trying to get his bearings, a task that was somewhat hindered by his sunglasses. He could tell by the darkness and the position of the moon that it was quite late. By now, someone should have woken him from his nap. Actually, he should have done so a long time ago. Further inspection revealed that the dinner dishes had never been cleared away. It was Patch's job to clear the dishes. Therefore, it followed that Patch was not doing his job, and that was wrong, because if there was one thing that could be said for Patch, it was that he was always doing his job. Edamon scratched his head, trying to work through the ramifications of the situation. It was clear that Patch was still missing. To his mind, that meant that Patch was probably in some kind of trouble. Not that this was a difficult thing to imagine, even for someone with Edamon's limited imagination. Patch was always getting into trouble, one way or another. But Patch's brand of trouble was usually just things being dropped or spilled or lost or broken. They didn't usually involve any damage coming to Patch himself beyond an occasional bump or scrape. For him to have vanished entirely, that little hairball gotten himself lost, Edamon realized. Somehow or another, Patch hadn't managed to be on board the trailers when they started moving, and he'd gotten left behind. Even now, he's probably wandering in circles in the endless desert, looking hopelessly for his Digimon, his Edamon-sama, and getting more and more lost. Well, what to do about it? Patch was only a servant, not even especially gifted in that respect. He was clumsy, he needed everything spelled out for him. He didn't perform any services that any of the other Gazimon couldn't have done just as well, maybe better. Someone of Edamon's power and reputation shouldn't have had to worry about mislaying a single subordinate, not when he could get another one, or 10, or 20, who could do the same thing. On the other hand, there were reasons for keeping him around. Very good and logical reasons that by necessity had to be there. Because Edamon didn't do things without good and logical reasons that had nothing to do with an emotional attachment to a floppy-eared runt of Digimon, meaning he didn't need to spend all night sitting around thinking about why he should or shouldn't go looking for him. It was all very clear in Edamon's mind. Everyone knew he didn't really need a misborn Gazimon to do his bidding, not when there were plenty of cleverer servants close at hand. Even if he could prove there was some reason for keep Patch around, whatever, skip that. There was just no way Edamon could wake up the entire camp right now to turn the caravan around to start combing the desert for a lost servant. When that was taken into consideration, there was really only one thing Edamon could do. He looked around. The room had a window, a large one, sufficient for admiring the scenery as he enjoyed his meals. He rattled it, attempted to open it, and when it proved obdurate, he smashed it to smithereens, relieving some of his frustrations with himself and the world in general. Then he leaped through the newly made opening, landing soundlessly on the sand, and went loping off into the night. It took a couple of hours and several miles before Edamon's more logical mind caught up with the rest of them. Despite what some of his compatriots might say, never to his face though, Edamon was not stupid. He had a certain amount of native cunning that allowed him to recognize and use the opportunities that came his way. He couldn't have gotten as far as he had in the world if he hadn't had a little bit of intelligence. It was simply that when it came to planning things out, he was a very slow thinker. He liked getting what he wanted, the way he wanted, when he wanted it, and having to sit down and think about it all irked him. It was much more gratifying to simply do whatever he wanted to do and be done with it. When he did sit down and think about things, it usually took him days or weeks to puzzle through whatever he was working on, and while whatever solution he eventually hit upon usually worked, it was much too tedious to do all the time. Now though, it occurred to him that maybe thinking this situation through a little more was not such a bad idea. Where was he going? He wasn't entirely sure. Out in the desert, unless he were aided by a map and compass or something equally reliable, it was easy to get lost. Even he, who of course possessed a flawless sense of direction, was forced to admit that it was marginally possible he'd gotten twisted around a bit while he was racing indiscriminately through the desert. Without any visible landmarks, he would have been hard-pressed to say where in this ocean of sand he actually was. Had he left in the direction his caravan had been traveling, or back the way... Had he left in the direction his caravan had been traveling, or back the way they had come? He couldn't remember. Oh, that figure he'd get lost. Too bad he doesn't have an angel woman to, you know, complain about him in that one movie. My daddy was all green. For that matter, where was Patch? Edamon hadn't thought to check. Though his computers probably could have told him if he bothered to look, probably he was back behind the trailers, heading back in their direction. On the other hand, the trailers had been parked for a while, and it was possible that Patch could have walked past them and missed them entirely. Edamon shook his head. He could spend hours trying to figure it out and never come to any sound conclusions. He dismissed all considerations except the simplest and most relevant. He had, by his estimation, approximately 3 hours before the sun rose. Once the sun rose, the other Gazimon would wake up. And if Edamon wasn't back in the camp by then, they would know something was up. He had 3 hours then to find Patch and get him back to camp before they were found out. 3 hours to search this whole empty desert when he didn't even really know where he was. Then an even uglier thought occurred to him. What if Patch had left on purpose? What if he had taken his guitar and walked off? It was true that Edamon didn't exactly treat him like much. If Patch had just been using him as a way to get access to the music he wanted, this would be just the time to run away. Surely he couldn't enjoy being pushed around and insulted day in and day out. Well, if that was the case, he could just sit out in the desert and rot for all Edamon cared. He had no use for thieving traitors, except he had thought Patch liked him. Edamon had hundreds of servants who would jump to answer his slightest whim, but not one of them honestly liked or admired him. They obeyed out of fear or greed, not any particular loyalty they had for their master. But he had thought Patch was different, and if it turned out it had all been a lie, With a snarl of frustration, Edamon hammered his fist down on an outcropping of rock, smashing it to gravel. Why did things like this have to happen to him? Why? All because he'd slipped up one little time and let himself form an attachment to someone who wasn't him. He halted in mid-rant. He had heard something. Somewhere in the distance, there was a piercing sound that carried on the still, dry desert air. It sounded like it was music. Edamon would know that sound anywhere, under any circumstances, and now he was aware that someone was playing a rollicking melody on a harmonica, less than a mile away. He focused his anger at the world in general to the harmonica player in particular. How dare anyone presume to make music in Edamon's domain? And when he was having a bad day, too. Well, Edamon would find whoever was making that noise they thought was music and ram that harmonica down their throat. Then they'd see what kind of music he would make. The sound might have been coming from a mile away across rolling dunes of slippery sand, but that was hardly enough to cause worry. Edamon might have been lazy, but Edamon might have been lazy by temperament, but that didn't mean he couldn't travel along at a terrific pace if he had to. It was only minutes later that he looked up to see the ridge of a forest rising up before him. The music was coming from there. So too was a twinkling light and the smell of smoke, as well as the soft chatter of voices, too muffled by distance to be distinct. He got the gist of it, though. Someone was out there having a good time when he wasn't. Well, he'd take care of that situation in short order. Then he got close enough to see just exactly who it was having the good time, and he stopped as if he'd walked into a tree. Sitting around a campfire were a group of strange creatures who could only be the chosen children he was supposed to be getting rid of. That was surprise enough, but he was doubly surprised to see that they were sharing their campfire with Patch. He was sitting between the boy with goggles and the boy with the harmonica, listening raptly to the music. Edamon felt a flash of fury. He had been betrayed. He gave a squawk of outrage that was audible even to the musician, and he dropped his song in mid-bar to see what had made it. Patch looked around, and his eyes lit up. "Edamon Chama," he squealed blissfully. "You came! Patch knew you would!" In the next moment, Patch had bounded across the sand to throw his arms around Edamon's leg, clinging there like a large gray bird. "Get off of me, you little runt!" said Edamon, absurdly pleased. The children were all staring at him, all wearing matching expressions of disbelief. "That's an Edamon?" asked the boy with the goggles. "That thing is the wonderful Edamon you couldn't wait to get back with?" Patch nodded agreeably, sitting back and gazing at his master with rapt adoration. Edamon decided it was time for some proper introductions to be made. "That's right," he said. He prodded Patch with his foot. "Don't just sit there. Give him a speech." "Right," Patch barked. He stood up straighter and began to recite in a clear tone that spoke of many rehearsals. "Ladies and gentlemen, introducing the masterful monkey, the supreme simian, the premier primate, the championship, and omnipotent orangutan." "Hurry it up already," Tai Chi shouted. Patch pouted. "I'm giving my speech," he said, as if speaking to an idiot. He cleared his throat and continued. "The ruler of the server deserts and lord of the dark network, I give you Edamon." There was no applause. Edamon acted as if there was anyway, while the children continued to stare. "Let me get this straight," said Kashiru. "You mean, this cute little Digimon we've been looking after, he works for the bad guys." Hey, I'm the baddest of the bad, and don't you forget it, Enemon bastard. I'm gonna teach you to mess with my servants, too. You're trespassing on my property, and I think it's time you learned who was boss around here. He intended to say more, and he would have, but he was interrupted by an oncoming yawn. After all, it was the middle of the night, and he'd been running around for a long time. Lucky for you, he continued, it's past my bedtime. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna let you off with a warning. We're impressed, said Yamato dryly. Yeah, well, you better be, Enemon replied, because the warning I'm giving you is about the dark network. Uh-oh, said Patch. You're in trouble now. The children looked at each other blankly. What's a dark network? Asked Mimi. The next sound she made was a shriek, as a black cable appeared out of nowhere and lashed itself around her, pinning her arms to her sides. Another one appeared, this one wrapping around her ankles. Palmon began trying to pry them away, but was just barely able to avoid being captured by another cable herself. Meanwhile, more and more cables were appearing out of the ground, latching to arms, legs, paws, tails, or anything else they could reach. Little Takira was almost completely enveloped by a cocoon of them, while his brother tried to beat them off with a stick from the campfire, and Gabumon slashed at them with his paws. Every time they cut one, it burst into sparks and vanished, but more and more kept appearing. Piyomon, Biomon in, I guess, the English translation. Piyomon pecked frantically at the cords that had bound Sora's wrists and seemed to be trying to drag her underground, while Agumon set several of those nearest to Tai on fire. There was a snap and a flash. Tentomon had become fed up with it simply trying to tug the cords away and had resorted to more forceful methods. He shot an electric arc at the nearest cable, and the spark struck and crackled down the length of the cable, making it fizz and drop lifelessly to the ground. Incredibly, a few of the cords on the other side of the glen abruptly did the same thing.
Alright, last page. I'm going to speed through it. Well, not really speed through it, but last part.
Well, what do you know? Said Kashiro, sounding impressed. He had the leisure to be curious, now that the cables were no longer bothering. It really is a network. They're all connected. Techno talk later, said Sora, trying to keep a cord from wrapping around her neck. Right now, we've got other things to worry about. Don't worry, I've got it all figured out, said Kashiro. Tentomon, give me a hand here. Ow! By taking it up a level. You've got it. Tentomon, Digivolve to Kabuterima. Wow, that was embarrassing. Several of the trees were pressed back as a huge flying insect appeared in the clearing. With his claws, he was able to reach into the sandy ground and pull up a double handful of writhing black cable. With a shout of command, he sent a burst of electricity up the wires, and each of them flashed briefly before falling limply and disappearing. Children and Digimon clashed with relief. Well, said Shiro as his partner shifted back to normal, that was easy. Easy for you to say. Well, no, that's not Digimon, sorry. Easy for you to say, said Yamato, picking his harmonica up out of the sand. If that was his warning, I'm not looking forward to seeing him really mad. Him really get mad. I knew that that little Digimon was trouble, said Taichi to no one in particular. I knew he was trouble, and nobody listened to me. I guess next time, we'll just have to remember that little Digimon can have big friends, said Jill. Big, ugly friends who might think it would be fun to strangle us.
Who's a nice little Digimon, said Tuxedo. Do you think we'll see him again?
I don't want to, said Tai Chi. Where is he anyway?
He looked around. During the commotion, both Patch and Enemon had disappeared.
He's gone, said Yamato. Looks like he took his guitar with him. Oh well, I can't say I'm going to miss him much.
Right now, said Tai Chi, all I'm missing is sleep. Somebody else can watch from now on.
It's my turn, said Sora. You get some rest. You've had a long night.
Thanks, Sora. Night, all. Quietly, the group settled back down to their usual nighttime routine, while Sora and Piyomon minded the fire. The rest curled up on the ground, closing their eyes to rest and sleep, and to forget about their new enemy. Until next time. Out in the desert, Edamon paused in his running to let Patch catch up. The little creature was still shuffling and stumbling along on his oversized paws, dragging his guitar behind him, and he was having a hard time keeping pace with his master. Edamon scowled as the little creature stopped a few feet away and plumped onto the sand.
What's the matter with you? He demanded.
Tired, Patch panted. Hungry.
Oh, you're more trouble than you're worth, you know that? Making me come all the way out here in the middle of the night.
Shall we?
What were you doing out here anyway?
Patch sat up and offered the guitar for inspection.
It ran away.
And Patch had to catch it. It fell out of the trailer.
Edamon told Patch not to lose it, so Patch chased it.
Then he couldn't get back. Patch is sorry he did wrong. What should he have done?
Edamon opened his mouth to answer the question, realized there was no good answer, and shut it. He couldn't say Patch should have left the thing in the desert, not after he'd been ordered to take good care of it. He sighed.
Wow, someone got Edamon to shut up for a second.
You did right, he finally said. You shouldn't have lost it in the first place, but seeing as how it's you, I should have known you couldn't keep up with it.
Patch hung his head. Patch is sorry. Here. He proffered the guitar, and Edamon stared at it as if it were a dead fish.
What am I supposed to do with this? He asked.
Patch didn't take care of it like Edamon Sharma told him to. Take it back. Patch can't take care of it right. Don't deserve it.
Edamon continued to stare. Patch wanted that guitar more than anything else in the world. Why was he trying to give it back?
I don't want that dirty old thing, he said. You've got it all scuffed up. I can't take it back now. Keep it.
Patch yipped for joy, hugging the instrument to his chest.
Thank you.
Yeah, keep your fur on. Stupid thing belongs in a junk pile anyway. Come on, we've got to get back before someone misses me.
He began walking again. Patch tried to get up, stumbled, and fell. He whimpered, and Edamon looked skyward in annoyance.
Nothing but trouble, he said. We're never going to get anywhere at this rate. Guess there's just one thing to do.
Much to Patch's surprise, Edamon scooped him up and swung him over his shoulder. He blinked a moment in surprise, then sighed and relaxed. Edamon began loping along again, hardly noticing the extra weight.
Patch didn't weigh anything. He was sure he had guitars back home that weighed more than the little dog creature did.
It was unbelievable that he was going through so much for the sake of something so small and helpless.
Nothing but trouble, he said again. Why do I go through so much trouble for you, huh? Answer me that.
But there was no answer. Smiling contentedly in his master's arms, Patch had gone to sleep.
Well, that's all there is of monkey business. I hope she makes more of it, because I thought it was really good. I mean, I like Digimon and stuff, of course, but, you know, there wasn't too many grammar mistakes, and I don't know, I just liked how she worded a lot of stuff, if it is a girl. I'm sorry if you're not, Silvermoon. But yeah, I thought it was at least worth a read. And next time I will try doing a Gurren Lagann fanfiction, and it's going to be a shounen-a one, so, yeah. If you like that fight, if you think it's funny, go ahead and watch it, whatever. I'll see you guys again. Where did I set the sunglasses?